I'll be your moderator tonight. My name is Andrea Harden. I'm the Energy and Climate Campaigner with the Council of Canadians. So thank you everybody for being here and braving the weather. I'm from Ottawa. It looks like I brought you our snow. I noticed this morning that it didn't have any, so I thought I'd bring some. We still surprisingly have some slowly melting, but there you go. A little present from Ottawa. I want to recognize, so tonight, the Council of Canadians is sponsoring this event. It's being co-hosted by the Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition. We have a number of other co-sponsors. We've got some tables at the back. They have lots of information. So if you haven't visited them yet, I encourage you to do so. They are the Wilderness Committee of Manitoba Field Office, the University of Winnipeg Students Association, Fun Class, UWSA, 350.org, and Boreal Action Center, and Pyro. So thank you to all of our co-sponsors for being here and supporting us. Off by talking very briefly about what's bringing us here tonight on this cold, blustery evening, and that's some TransCanada's proposed energy east pipeline. So what this is a 1.1 million barrel per day pipeline from Alberta to St. John, New Brunswick. Their intention is to convert an existing natural gas pipeline between Saskatchewan and a place called Cornwall near Iqaluit, and then attach new pipeline through the rest of Ontario all the way to St. John, New Brunswick. I put up this infographic just to get us rolling tonight so we have a sense of what we're talking about when we talk about Energy East. At 1.1 million barrels per day, it's hands down the largest pipeline being proposed yet. So if you look here, you've got the Trans Mountain, that's the Kinder Morgan pipeline. It would increase up to 890,000 barrels per day. Keystone XL was 830,000 barrels per day. The Gateway Pipeline, obviously, hopefully we all know right now, that's pretty much dead in the water. That's 525,000 barrels per day. Energy East is almost twice that amount. So when we're talking about this particular project, we are talking about the biggest tar sands pipeline proposed to date. And that absolutely has an effect on what it means if there's a consequence, be it small-scale frequent spills that they can't detect from their leak detection systems, which we'll talk a little bit about, or if it's the kind of large-scale spill that happened in Kalamazoo, Michigan. That spill, if you heard about it, it dumped diluted bitumen into the Kalamazoo River. It took 17 hours. If Energy East was flowing at full capacity, it could spill the same amount in 17 minutes. So let's bear this in mind when we're talking about the Energy East pipeline. The sheer capacity of this particular project is quite startling. It would see 282 large oil tankers fly the Bay of Fundy waters. That's because it is an export pipeline, another thing that we're going to talk about here tonight, to myth up one of these common myths we keep hearing. But what I want to do is give you a bit of a lay of the land of what we're going to do here tonight and then pass it over to Chickadee Richard to get us started. So what we're going to do is we're going to have a series of presentations from speakers. Hopefully you saw in our promotion the posters who's here speaking tonight, and I've got the honor of being able to be up here and introducing all of these wonderful people. I'm so happy to join here tonight. And then following that, in between, I'll throw up a couple of slides with some key facts, and you'll be able to jot them down if you have any interest in it. Towards the end of the evening, I'll talk about what's on your chair, and then we're also going to have a short Q&A. In terms of process, what I'll do is I'll take three questions, and then I'll give them an opportunity to respond. I will ask that comments from the floor be contained to 1 minute, and I'm a bit of a stickler as a moderator, so watch it. That's your one warning. So without further ado, I do want to take the opportunity now to welcome Chickadee Richard. I'm so glad she's here. She's a Treaty 1 advocate, a grandmother, and has wonderful things to say. So thank you, Chickadee.
I came a little prepared today. But I did this with prayer before I put it together. Anything that I do, I make with prayer, and the things that I do out in the community, we always acknowledge the ancestors and the grandmothers and grandfathers. So, Wujou, first and foremost, I would like to acknowledge the ancestral lands of the Anishinaabe. We have creation stories and songs which tell us of a time that we were lowered to this land, hence came the name of the Anishinaabe. And we have been here since time immemorial and have a relationship to the lands, which is part of our DNA. This is Treaty 1 territory, a treaty that needs to be worked on rebuilding the relationship of our ancestors, made in good faith and trust. So true justice will prevail and honor can be brought back to your ancestors. Across the lands, we are governed by natural laws which correct things. For us, as long as we believe in the ways of our ancestors, we will always have that connection to our homelands. I want to greet you all and welcome you all to our traditional territory, which is Treaty 1 territory. And to all the visitors, the grandmothers, the grandfathers, the youth, the children, I welcome you all to Treaty 1 territory. So, welcome to the event that is bringing awareness to the crisis of our water all over the world and how important it is we come together to work on this common issue that affects us all. As indigenous people, we feel the contamination and the health of the waters firsthand. As you see, there are over 130 water boil advisories across Canada. The man-made disasters that are waiting to happen in the name of development. We are at a crossroads in our lives to make the conscious choice of the survival of our water and lands and the lives of beings in which we share the lands with. All over the world, we see indigenous people loving the waters and the lands. They are doing this with heart and vision for the future generation and all life, yet we are still marginalized in many ways of the NGOs and the environmental groups who speak on our behalf of our lands and the peoples who are being affected daily firsthand on the front lines with little or no support of resources or funds to continue loving our future from further devastation and destruction. Well, many of you have not met the front lines people and have sat with them at their homelands that they were protected. I know this firsthand because I've gone to many front lines and I've sat with the people and they say, where are the environmentalists? Where are they? And I have no answer for them. One of the things that I was taught by my elders is that if you want to know something about where there's a blockade or they're doing some kind of a demonstration, you go to them, directly to them, and hear from them. And not from the news or the papers, because it's always that a little too shady, and it's always looking at us in a different way as First Nations people. We as Indigenous people are all connected by the lands and waters. There are markers on traditional territories of our peoples, knowing whose territory we're on, names given since time immemorial, where we still hunt, gather, fish, and use the lands as our pharmacy and our food security. We know that once our lands and waters are destroyed, then we have no other place to go. Some of you may have homelands that your ancestor came from, and you can go back if needed. We don't have anywhere to go. This is our homeland. This is our homeland. This is where Creator placed us. This time, I want to stress to the greater society who have privilege in making a difference and stand in solidarity with Indigenous people to love our waters and our lands by standing with us on the front lines and helping us with resources and funds to do the work that we must do to protect for generations to come. As a mother and grandmother, I also challenge the women who have children and grandchildren to think of how are you securing the future for your children and grandchildren, and remind you of your first vow to your children to protect them from any harm and always to look out for their best interest. We have to remember that if the waters become contaminated with any kind of industrial waste or mismanagement of industry, such as Mount Polly for the uranium mining that has damaged water in Pine Ridge, South Dakota. We are allowing harm to come to them, which will hurt them forever, not having the same privileges as we had to have clean and healthy waters and lands. We as mothers and grandmothers need to stand together for the survival of the future generations. And I also want to acknowledge our allies and those in the past and present who have walked with us and continue to support the well-being of our Mother Earth. I say Chimiigwech for all that. And I say Miigwech, and I hope that you enjoy the speakers and that you commit to making a better future for all. Miigwech.
Michael, he's been a member of the Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition for over a year and will address local Winnipeg risks from Energy East and their organizing plans. You can find out more about MEJC at their table and also at www.noenergyeastnb.org. A few years ago, Michael participated in a Quebec exchange program. That experience was a catalyst for his community organizing involvement. And we're certainly happy that that did exactly that. And just want to say I have the privilege of working on an Energy East campaign from Ottawa, but working with several regional offices and grassroots organizations and landowners. And I got to say, Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition is doing some really incredible work here in Winnipeg. And if you don't know about them and the amazing work that they're doing, I really do encourage you to go back to that table and talk to them, because it's well worthwhile. I'm sitting in on one of those meetings or checking out our Winnipeg chapter. They're leading the way on this.
Thank you, Andrea. Welcome. Chickadee, Daryl, Maude, thanks for being here tonight. Thank you all for joining us. My name is Michael Matczuk. I'm with the Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition. We are a coalition of concerned individuals and community groups who came together originally to oppose the Energy East pipeline. We, of course, have a broader vision of making a transition to a carbon-free economy, towards energy justice. We'll talk a little bit later about what we've been doing and what we hope to do. Now, I'm sure we're going to hear a lot tonight about the risks of the Energy East pipeline and how it affects us in Manitoba. We've heard already that a portion of the pipeline is intended to be used as old pipeline. So basically, what TransCanada wants to do is convert this 40-year-old natural gas pipeline and pump diluted bitumen through it, which of course sounds like a horrible idea. It is. But the situation that's unique for Winnipeg is that from Winnipeg to Shoal Lake, the pipeline runs, as you can see on the slide here, the pipeline runs within the spill reach of our 100-year-old concrete aqueduct. So this 40-year-old gas line carrying diluted bitumen even crosses directly underneath our 100-year-old concrete aqueduct. It's a low-pressure system. So it's gravity-fed, which means that where the aqueduct sits above the groundwater, it spills, it leaks water. Where it sits below the groundwater, it has groundwater and potential contaminants leak into it. Where the public pipeline is south of the aqueduct, the groundwater drains north. And where it's north of the aqueduct, the groundwater drains south. Any small, slow, undetected leaks near the aqueduct could invariably pass with the groundwater into the aqueduct itself. And it would take only 55 liters of benzene to contaminate the entire Deakin Reservoir, which holds 30 days worth of water for Winnipeg. That would be about 100 barrels of diluted bitumen. Undetected leaks of up to 2.6 million liters a day, I think we saw on the last slide, can go undetected. That's 2.6 million liters a day can go undetected by TransCanada. Their documents say that this pipeline already leaks. There's records of natural gas leaks on all their above ground components. Now they say it doesn't leak below ground, and I guess we have to believe them, right? Because it's all below ground, so. They do tell the truth, yeah. I met with a gentleman from TransCanada at one of their open houses, and I asked what would happen if this diluted bitumen line that runs in with six other natural gas pipelines should catch fire due to one of the gas lines exploding. And he said to me, that's never happened before. I thought that was pretty interesting. So I went and found a gentleman who was in charge of the emergency cleanup. And I asked him what would happen should one of the gas lines, or should the pipeline carrying diluted bitumen rupture in St. Norbert, where it crosses through the LaSalle River and the Red River. He said that's never happened before. But he showed me this really fancy diagram of a bunch of absorbent buoys and some boats and stuff like that in the river, and how they would just catch the oil as it travels downstream. And the problem with that is that it's not oil, it's diluted bitumen. It's heavier than oil, so it sinks. It's also very, very corrosive. So this 40-year-old natural gas line that's already in really poor condition really doesn't stand a chance. The analog of comparison of this pipeline is to that of an underground storage tank. We know that storage tanks contaminate groundwater all over North America, all over the world. This pipeline could be considered a very, very long, old, pressurized storage tank that threatens water supplies, aquifers, and watersheds right across the province. The aqueduct is in the best possible place for its purpose, but the gas line proposed by TransCanada for conversion is in the worst possible place for an oil line. Now, had TransCanada proposed to put an oil line in this location 40 years ago, the city would have refused it, flat out. It's the worst possible place. I don't even think that TransCanada would have had the audacity to propose it in the first place. What kind of detection system could be installed to effectively monitor benzene in the marshland that the aqueduct crosses? What could possibly be done to mitigate the damage after benzene was detected? When would the decision be made to shut down the aqueduct and the water supply of Winnipeg? Who would pay to supply water with Winnipeg once it has none? It's likely that a full-blown environmental assessment has never been done of this spill reach. Because natural gas doesn't have the same contamination risks as diluted bitumen. But for sure, If this was proposed 40 years ago, the city would have said no. I don't know why they would consider it now. The city has a statutory obligation to provide safe drinking water in Winnipeg. They have exclusive control over the land that the aqueduct uses. And it's entered into a 3 easement agreements with TransCanada that allow for conveyance of gas and nothing else. And these agreements contain an indemnity and provide for compensation in the event that the water supply is interrupted, but not destroyed. The focus on the agreement is the crossing point of the pipelines and the aqueduct, and not the entire spill reach. For the Energy East project to proceed, the city has to agree to an amendment of the easement to allow liquid petroleum products and to have the easement agreement assigned to Energy East. Both would require the written agreement of the city. And the city can't be, the assignment cannot be arbitrarily withheld. But saying no, just because the plan is to convey oil instead of gas, wouldn't be considered arbitrary. By agreeing or by entering into a new agreement, the city would be consenting to the route that allows petroleum liquids to be conveyed through this spill reach. Now, the city has applied to intervene for the National Energy Board, and we've taken the position with Manitoba Energy Justice Coalition that the city must thoroughly investigate the risks of conversion in order to effectively intervene in the NEB process and to reach a suitable agreement with TransCanada should they choose to do so. We're worried that the city has neither the political will to adequately protect the interests or residents of the city, or the resources, and have recommended that the Public Utilities Board hold hearings and, if appropriate, provide guidance to the city. We've focused on the danger to Winnipeg's water, but also water supplies for Sanford, Portage, Brandon Rivers, Sioux Valley, and Kenton are also in danger. So we met with several city councilors, MPs, MLAs, and are continuing to pursue meetings with others. We've presented to the city and the province, political and staff committees. Various community and labor organizations have invited us to present on the Energy East. We've held our own community-level town halls in St. Norbert, St. Boniface, and Linden Woods. We're canvassing door-to-door and have excellent crews helping us canvass. Thank you, volunteers. We're collecting hundreds of signed postcards directed to the province and to the city, to the premier and to the mayor. We table at events across the city. You can find our table in the back corner there. Please visit us when we're done here tonight. I'd love it if you would take a moment to sign the postcards that we're collecting. We've produced blogs, op-eds, letters to politicians and to the NEB, 2 full-length reports on the Energy East pipeline in Manitoba, which are available on our website. Again, that's www.noenergyeastmb.org. And our work emphasizes that while the aqueduct and other water supplies must be protected, both the city and the province must learn to put climate first in every decision that they make. Climate is not someone else's responsibility. It's the responsibility of every level of government and every citizen. On the federal level, the Liberal government seems to think that destroying the climate with this carbon-spewing Energy East pipeline is a fine way to transition to green, sustainable economy. I know, you know, the best thing that I can think of now is an all-protein diet. Which would be a great way to lose weight. Here in Winnipeg, we have an excellent representative of this Pipelines for Green Transition. We have the Minister of Pipelines and Tar Sands, officially known as the Minister of Natural Resources, Jim Carr. It's Mr. Carr's responsibility to apply climate science to the natural resource sector. Instead, he's recently shares that he shares common goals and principles with proponents of energy use. It almost seems like he wants to get oil to tidewater so that oil companies can rake in their last-ditch profits before the climate catches up and it's too late. It's too late. MEJC recognizes the need to build public pressure in opposition to the Liberal Party's pro-oil industry agenda. The best place to do that is right here in Winnipeg, where we can put that pressure to work on Jim Carr. Thank you. And that's the campaign that we're building right now. We welcome new volunteers. We've put together several workshops so that you'll feel well informed and comfortable as you join us in this wonderful work. There's a really great training opportunity this Saturday, hosted by the Council of Canadians and MEJC at the Hive at 10 a.m. at the University of Winnipeg. Workshops on dealing with media and on canvassing skills. There's a French media workshop at noon, an atelier en français à midi, so that any francophones can get a better grip on the technical terms. There is a registration sheet for those workshops at the Council of Canadian table at the back of the room. Now, again, before you leave, I'd like everybody to stop by. If you have any questions for our staff and volunteers, if you have a minute to sign our postcards. Now, I was here a year ago. It was my introduction to MEJC and the Council of Canadians and the Energy East Project. That fine bearded gentleman in the corner stopped by my place canvassing with the Wilderness Committee and he told us about the event that was being held. I showed up, bugged it, made my way to the town hall meeting in St. Norbert and have been harassing MEJC ever since to give me work and more flyers to have signed and a job. I never thought I'd be standing up here. And it's really exciting. I do a lot of door-to-door inviting people to our events, trying to collect signatures. It sure is taking a long time, though. I do need everybody to stop, if you can, if you haven't already, to sign our postcards. Each and every one of you who think that it might be possible to get 5 postcards signed at home, 10 postcards signed amongst your family and your friends, please come and speak with us. We need your help. We need this to start escalating a lot more quickly. I look forward to meeting you. I'm glad you all made it out tonight. We have a lot more to talk about. Thank you.
On this, thank you for making sure that the climate piece of the energy situation was mentioned tonight. It's really critical. So very briefly, filling the pipeline means 30 to 32 million tons of climate pollution every year. Simply, this is more climate pollution than the entire province of Manitoba creates in 1 year. That's a heck of a lot of climate pollution. Now, we have a new federal government, and there's a lot of feeling of hope around this federal government and different opinions on that. But surely, this government, we saw them go to the Paris climate talks, and we saw them give support to a 1.5 degree limit on global temperature rise, and that's going to be even tougher to get to than the 2 degree limit that many people have been talking about. Frankly, it's what we need in order to live in a safe climate. There is no way a pipeline that's going to last 40 years beyond 2050, when we're supposed to be aiming towards a fossil-free future, pumping 1.1 million barrels per day of some of the heaviest, most climate-polluting, most water-destructive oil makes any sense with a 1.5 degree target. So one of the things that we'll be coming back to later is Minister Carr is responsible for some of the interim principles and changes that are coming to the pipeline project reviews, and one of the pieces that we're working on with MEJC, but a number of groups, is making sure that the climate test that they've agreed to, and it is an important step, that they have agreed to it. The previous government refused to do that. But make sure that it's actually effective and gets us towards doing our fair share towards a 1.5 degree target. So the fight on climate and pipelines is not over. It's about actually evaluating this pipeline for what it really is, and we strongly believe that if we do, that means rejecting the pipeline. And we strongly believe, too, if we want to protect waterways, it also means rejecting the pipeline. And that's what that postcard actually says, Director Mayor. So I want to take the opportunity now to welcome our next speaker. I had the opportunity to meet Daryl Redsky when Maude and I and a couple of us went and visited Shoal Lake 40 last April when the ice was thinning. And that was quite a harrowing experience, yet put in perspective for us of, you know, having to do it once versus people living there for years and that being their home and that being exactly what they face every day. It's ever since that experience, it's certainly been close to my heart in terms of doing what I can do to make sure people understand and hear the story of Shoal Lake 40. And I'm glad there has been progress, but I do know, you know, 2 nights ago a truck went through on the ice. You know, that's got to change. That shit's got to change. So, perhaps some strong language from the front, apologies, I'll blame it on the pregnancy. But there was no way to really come here and talk about protecting drinking water and talk about the energy use pipeline and not talk about Shoal Lake 40 and what's going on with Winnipeg's drinking water. That just doesn't make sense. So I'm very happy that Daryl Redsky is here with us. He was quoted recently as saying, "It is not our job to protect this territory of Shoal Lake." Oops, sorry. It is not our job to protect the earth. It is our responsibility to sustain what has been left. We can't continue to allow things to be overdeveloped. We all have a duty and a responsibility. It's not just our people, it's everybody. We all live here.
I'll introduce myself and my language. I have a little, I've always had a problem speaking in front of people. So it's something that I've become accustomed to lately in the past little while. But I just wanted to introduce myself in my language. My name is Neil Galvo. I took a note there, Vision Home Tech, Schabe, which tag in the world. As you know, my name is Daryl Redsky, Shoal Lake 40. I'm the consultation officer for the community. And with my job, I do get involved in a lot of these kind of issues that deal with the land, protecting the waters, the lands, the resources. I didn't quite come prepared as my colleagues here, but I do have a lot that I can share living on the land that I can do my best to express the best way that I know how. Chickadee is right when it comes to protecting, defending our lands and resources. Unfortunately, our ancestors, my people, have a long history in doing that. I am no different to that environment. I've been on the front lines. I've been in the trenches. So I think it's with that experience that I bring with me to share with everybody in this room that feels that our land is being compromised. Mother Earth is being jeopardized. She is crying right now. And she's going to heal herself. We see those signs all around the globe. Things are happening we've never seen before. And I'm talking about the weather. was a younger man. I took my son out on the lake, and we went fishing, and we went for a boat ride, and we went swimming. This was 15, 20 years ago. I could drink right out of the lake. I could stick my head in the water and drink as much water as I wanted to. That's how clean that water supply, the lake is. That was 15, 20 years ago. I can't do that anymore without fear of getting sick. Even the water is crying. The water gives us life. It gives all of us life. It built this beautiful building. If that's concrete, you need water to mix the concrete. Everything that you see in this beautiful city was built with the water from my home. It was used to help give life to Trinity One, to help Trinity Three water. I'm really happy to see, and it makes me feel good to hear the stuff that's being said. Because for so long, I felt isolated. We felt like we've been working in isolation. We've been saying it for years and years and years. You ask anything about the environment, you go to the people who live on the land. They will tell you. That's the history that I've seen. But things are changing now. Why I say that is because I'm looking at a room full of people who feel the time has come to work together. Our people have always been willing to work with you. We have always been prepared to share what it will take to maintain and keep our resources clean. It only takes something like a pipe full of oil to bring us together. This is the second snake that I'm going to be dealing with next. But I'm pretty confident that we can beat this second snake if we all work together. I've been invited to the city a few times to talk about the issue. And the first concern that I have is like all of you, is what will happen when that pipeline ruptures. Because I'm not convinced. Cannot convince me that it won't. It will. And when it does, rupture in my territory, in my backyard, it's going to affect my people first. I don't know how long it will take before it affects you here. Days, I have no idea, but it will My people haven't engaged over the past 100 years fighting for their survival. And we've been denied our basic human rights. The first fight was when our neighbors came in to our territory. The governments of the day forcefully removed my ancestors from where they were happily living. That's when the first snake appeared. And we've been fighting for over 100 years now. It wasn't what the people of the city, it wasn't what the governments, that they have allowed to do. We have shared our land with you so that you could have life, water. Now we must come together again and share in this fight to fight the next thing. We were never consulted on that whole Trans-Canada issue. The first pipeline, we were never informed of that. Now with this pipeline that's already there, it's going to be running oil, I have never had any conversations with anybody regarding that. And it's 10, 12 kilometers from my house. I've waited for somebody to call me and have a conversation with me that hasn't happened. I waited for my phone to ring because I am prepared, and I have been prepared to sit down with those people and have them try to convince me. Because in my job, I always tell industry, it's my job to protect my community and my resources. If you can convince me, you'll have no problem convincing my community. Nobody has convinced me on anything. Nobody's even contacted me on anything regarding the pipeline. I am strongly opposed to having that in my backyard. I have told my chief what my feelings are. When somebody asks me something and wants me involved, 90% of the time, they do not like to hear what I have to say. Because I will say what needs to be said. And I'm talking names, industry, other people. I'm not talking about you folks here. But what I'm saying is, I will do everything that I can do as an individual to make our community fully aware of what the impacts are and what's coming. I will engage in the same type of campaign that has brought, we're surely 40 days now, we have in the community a group of men women, youth, and elders that we call the price of water. The price of water group was consisted of community members outside of the chief and council. The price of water group is what got us to where we are today. We have accomplished a lot in 2 years. It was all strategically, tactically planned. Remember, I've been on the front lines. I've been in the trenches. This is the first time that I've been involved in a campaign where I have not had to put on fatigues or cover my face. And that comes from experience from the other places that I've been to. We will be prepared. We will stand side by side with whoever to protect what we have. The water. Let me tell you about a little dream I had a little while ago. I've only told this to a couple people. I'll share it with all of you. And as all of you know, how dreams are, sometimes they're a little crazy. Mine was a bit crazy. So it's in some land where there's shorelines and hills, but there's a flood going on. There's a lot of water. Water was in my dream. So in my dream, there are people along with me as the water's rising. While this water is rising, this big snake appears out of nowhere. You could see it moving under the ground, coming out of the water and rearing its ugly head on the ground and back into the ground. To make a long story short, somebody had the guts, the courage, to stop that snake in its tracks. And then my alarm went off. Interpret that dream any way you like, but the way that I interpret that is there were people in my dream and that they did stop that pipeline. Now that
community has managed to survive, we can now address the issues that need to be addressed. If I could give an example, when Minister Zimmer came to my community, as my chief told him, other communities are up here, thriving the best they can. They have a bit of economy, they got a bit of resource, they got the structure, infrastructure. Surely 40 has been down here. And these communities have been battling industry, fighting for treaty rights. Surely 40 is down here. We're just struggling to survive, never mind fighting for treaty rights. He told the minister, once we're up here with the rest of the First Nations, watch out, because we will stand and fight, because we've been fighting for our lives all this time. I'm confident in our abilities to work together. I say that because we already have a relationship. We've established that. But I think we can make it better, we can make it stronger. Focus our energies on stopping and protecting the water that we all share. Everybody in this room is 60, 70, 80% Shoal Lake.
Yeah.
You're fighting for yourself. So, I mean, I can't talk eloquent as my colleagues here, but I can share my experience, my lived experience with people. Like I said, we have built allies, built bridges. I see a familiar friend here. We have a water alliance with him. Those are the kind of relationships that we have built. You know, it's all about water. For Shoal Lake, it's a turn of the tap. For him, it's a flick of the switch. We need to continue developing those, to protect that resource and everything that it gives life to, including all of us. You betcha.
Thank you so much, Daryl, for sharing that, sharing your experiences. water. Well, I wanted to throw in this slide here. That's actually a picture of the Kalamazoo River. That's where the Enbridge pipeline burst and spilled diluted bitumen. You can kind of see the oily sheen there. That's, I suppose, what happens when diluted bitumen spills is it's on top of the water for a little bit of time, and then the diluents that they use to make it thin enough, because bitumen is very heavy, what happens is those evaporate off, which actually raises some concerns around health risks for local residents, and then the bitumen sank. So it actually went around 60 kilometers down the river, and then it sank, right? And TransCanada, what they like to do is they say, all oil sinks. It's true. If you leave oil and water long enough, it will all sink. It will all sink. What they don't like to talk about is how fast diluted bitumen sinks. and how hard it is to clean it up when it does sink. Because not only does it sink, it's very sticky and it attaches to everything. So basically, the cleanup of the Kalamazoo River, for parts of it, was dredging the bottom of the riverbed. And for anybody who understands anything about river ecology, you know that that's not a good idea. But more and more, we're beginning to learn the particular risks of diluted bitumen. And I will highlight, this is a multi-use oil pipeline, so there will be other oils running it through. But we do know that most of the supply will come from Alberta, and most of what's being produced there right now that will flow through is diluted bitumen. Recently, the U.S. National Academy of Sciences concluded that diluted bitumen sinks far quicker, and that first responders in the oil industry are not prepared to handle major spills of water. That's not Greenpeace, that's not Council of Canadians, it's the U.S. National Academy of Sciences, right? Most comprehensive review to date saying they are not prepared. Canada is no different. We don't have special spill equipment that the U.S. doesn't have. So this goes for us too. Brigitte, can you move it forward? So briefly before talking a little bit about Maude, there's been a poll going around lately about MGEs, suggesting that the majority of Canadians support it, but that there's regional differences. And this poll is interesting in that it contradicts other polls we've seen. One last year, and it was April, by Climate Action Network that actually found the majority of people did not support the pipeline. Consistently, polls that are more thorough in Quebec find 6 out of 10 Quebecers are opposed to this project, quite strongly so. In fact, that first poll found people in Manitoba, by and large, actually didn't support the MGE's pipeline. But I raise it because it's being used to again bring up this narrative that this is a nation-building pipeline, there isn't a lot of opposition to it, it's a no-brainer, and it cannot be further from the truth. It cannot. So I just want to show a couple of images here, and I know that Maude is going to speak to this a little bit more. So that's actually the CEO of TransCanada, if you didn't recognize him by his face there. But Kakuta Showdown, this is the first big win against the Energy's pipeline, and it's important to acknowledge it here. TransCanada had the wonderful idea of putting an export port beside a protected beluga habitat in the St. Lawrence. I guess they thought nobody was going to be concerned about that. Well, thousands of people mobilized in Quebec and were up in arms about it. And sure enough, because of that grassroots effort, Kakuta is absolutely dead down. It does not exist within TransCanada's application. And because of that change, the whole operational date for when this pipeline is going to start was moved back by 2 years. So anybody familiar with TransCanada? Happened. Warning number one, TransCanada. Let's flip forward. I had to throw in a picture of Cool Pache New. It's an amazing grassroots network in Quebec that's leading the charge against Energy East. For anybody who's followed politics in Quebec, you'll know the student movement is incredibly strong there. Gabriel Nadeau Dubois was a key figure. He actually has become part of the anti-pipeline movement, got a prize of $25,000. on a very public provincial TV show said, I'm going to donate this to Cool Pache New, and I challenged Quebecers to match my $25,000. Well, what was it, a couple of days? It was over $200,000 that went to Cool Pache New, a grassroots network. So they've got a pretty little purse that they're working with, and believe it, they are mobilizing. There's a reason why Montreal mayors came out opposed to the Energy's pipeline. Not only does it pose a direct risk to their drinking water in Montreal, the second largest city in Canada, there is also an incredibly strong and powerful alliance between environmentalists and Indigenous communities growing within that province and are pushing hard. And students are getting involved. That's one to watch on Energy East. I wanted to highlight this. So oftentimes there's this myth that New Brunswick is strongly in support of the Energy East pipeline. Not true. Don't believe it. This is a picture of an 800-strong march that happened to the end of the pipeline route in St. John. This is where they want to hold millions of barrels of oil in these 11-story tanks literally across the street from a Council of Canadians supporter who's mobilizing in our community. 800 people from Atlantic Canada came to that march. There was Indigenous representation, there was religious groups there were labor unions there. Landowners are starting to mobilize in that province. And while their elected officials might be saying one thing, watch out, that's a fight to watch. The Grand Wolfstone Council in New Brunswick has already declared that they are opposed to Energy East. Treaty 3, Eagle Lake First Nation, Iroquois in Quebec, the list goes on. So when you hear that this is a no-brainer pipeline and that it's got political support, that just ain't true. And that's something that proponents of this project are trying to get out there to convince people to not worry about this and focus on other things. And we're here to tell you it's just not the case, and we all have a reason to be here and to get involved. So I don't want to take any more of your space away from Maude Barlow. I have a biography here for her. I know she will cut me off and not let me say it, so I'm not going to say it, don't worry. I've had the pleasure of working with Maude for close to 8 years. I was incredibly lucky to land my dream job at the Council of Canadians. I wrote an essay about Maude Barlow and water protection when I was in university, was a huge fan then, and have had the pleasure to get to know Maude at events like this, and she is just as passionate and just as capable as she appears to be on stage. And more than anything, I think the word, when I think of Maude, everybody thinks water, yes, but I think justice. Maude is a crusader for justice, trade justice, water justice, climate justice, for human rights. That is what Maude is about. That is what she will continue to be about. She is a force to be reckoned with. I've seen her go into lobbying meetings and walk out, and people are left wide-eyed. I've seen her go into community meetings and galvanize people. I'm so glad that we have Maude Barlow talking about Energy East and here tonight. And I hope you find her as inspiring as I do. Thank you, Andrea. Thank you very much for your beautiful words. We're lucky we landed you guys. You too. All of you, and I just want to say a shout out to Robert Chernomas, who's on our board and our treasurer, and is an economist at the University of Manitoba. Our team is incredible, and all of you are. Thank you. And thank you to Chickadee and Treaty 1 for the warm welcome here tonight. Very moving welcome. Michael, your words were absolutely beautiful. Michael told me this is the first time he's done that, we would never know. And Daryl, it has just been such a pleasure and an honor to get to know you and your community. As Andrea said, when we visited last spring, we were very deeply moved. I mean, it's one thing to read about a community that's going through this, and it's another to be there. And it is our pleasure and honor to do as much as we can and stand in solidarity with you. And I do believe this part of your story is coming to an end. And when I hear you say that, once you get there, you will be powerful. I think that's why they don't want you to get there. So, but if you get there, you will, and we will do it together. So there are so many reasons to oppose the Energy East pipeline. The increase in the tar sands production, as Andrea says, there's no way we could meet any climate. Far forget the 1.5, we could never meet even the modest agreement in Copenhagen. It's just not possible. The reality that it's not a pipeline that's for Western Canadians, for Eastern Canadians to have access to Western oil, and that is something that is such a myth that we really need to fight. This is a through pipeline, this is an export pipeline. It is to make a bunch of energy companies wealthier. It's not a job creator, and it is not a national unity creator either. And another huge reason to oppose it, and I think probably, I'll talk water in 1 second, but maybe the most important is that if we do go ahead with this pipeline, it means we're committing future generations to a fossil fuel future in our country. You don't put billions of dollars into something like a pipeline like this, and the increase in what's going to take place in the tar sands without saying,
okay, what won't we do? You will not be collectively looking to alternative sources of energy, to more sustainable energy. We will not have the facility. We will have put all our eggs in not only in the fossil fuel basket, but in probably the very worst fossil fuel basket that we possibly could. We can still get diluted bitumen is a form of poison, but which would be moving across our country for at least a part of it in very old pipelines that, my goodness, should probably be retired, not retrofitted. On water, you've heard the story here tonight. We took the map of the pipeline route and superimposed it over the map of all the waterways in Canada that it would cross. It would cross thousands of waterways, including going under the St. Lawrence River. People along the road, and I think it's really important point that Andrea made, which is when you read the Canadians think that this is a good project, well, what are they going to think if everybody's telling them that this is like building the railroad, that it's just another wonderfully unity project? But as people learn what it's really about along the road, they're saying no because they understand that it threatens their waterway. Andrea and I remember standing in North Bay at the very modern, state-of-the-art treatment center there, looking out this window with all the media there and the city officials and so on, and the manager showing us there's the pipeline. It's now a natural gas pipeline, but if it's the one that will be converted, and if it were to spill, here's where it would come in, and here's how it would clog, here's how fast it would clog in the intake, and it would be shut down, there'd be no water within a couple of hours. And we said, and then the plan is, and he said, there's no plan. We have no plan. There's no plan for after there's no water. No, I guess bringing in bottled water for the city of North Bay. So this is what we're dealing with. People have faith somehow that there's some technology that's going to come along, but it's not going to happen. Now, I'm not going to go into, you saw the danger to Winnipeg. I mean, we are talking about basically the pipeline running alongside the aqueduct at one point crossing it, but paralleling it. And a spill, a major spill, or even a slow leak could damage the drinking water here, potentially permanently. But I do want to say, against a backdrop, I want to talk a little bit about water and how important it is that we protect it. The global water crisis is here. It is as real as anything I could possibly tell you. Several weeks ago, one of the leading limnologists, a man named Arjen Hoekstra at the University of Twente in the Netherlands, put out a major report saying that probably almost 4/5 of humanity right now is living with at least 1 month of water crisis a year. He said that all of the studies that have been coming out of the UN and the World Bank and the Pacific Institute and so on are underestimating the extent of the crisis and how fast it's coming. Now, it's coming very fast at us for a number of reasons. Of course, global warming and climate change is one of them, but also the over-extraction of groundwater, the over-extraction of rivers, so the rivers, most rivers no longer reach the ocean, is here now with us in a planet that is becoming industrialized, urbanized. The more stuff we have, the more water we use, the more the water is taken out of our water systems. Just to give you a few examples, after the Second World War, China mapped all its major rivers. They say there are probably, at that time, there were about 50,000 up to 1990. Since 1990, the number of rivers that have disappeared in China, 26,000. Of 50,000 major rivers, 26,000 are gone. They don't know where they went. Well, I suppose we could figure where they went. A lot of it's for hydroelectric production. A lot of it's to make all of the goods that they ship all over the world. I mean, we have a country that was once water rich running out. Brazil is the example that I talk about the most because Brazil is still listed by the United Nations as being the country with the most water in the world. But they've taken down so much of the Amazon forest, the Amazon rainforest, that it's not producing the massive amounts of moisture that used to get carried on these great big convections of currents, air currents of moisture, basically they call them flying rivers. And by the way, there's more rain in flying rivers in our world, on our planet, than in rivers in the ground. I mean, this is how rain gets carried around the world.
And it used to be that these flying rivers would take the water thousands of kilometers down to Sao Paulo, and every year it would rain just right on cue. You could almost pick the day. They haven't had drought in their history. There's no recorded history of drought in Brazil. And now they say that the 21-some million people of greater Sao Paulo may have to be moved. They have no idea what they're going to do with the waters gone. 22 countries in Africa, Australia's in crisis, the United States, it's not just California, you've read about California, and by the way, California had lots of water. It was the abuse of moving water from one place to another to grow, in this one case, 80% of the world's almonds for export and so on, that has destroyed that state's water. But the Ogallala Aquifer, which is that massive aquifer that used to be the size of Lake Huron, that goes down the spine of the U.S. Midwest, the Department of Agriculture says will be gone probably within 50 years, but certainly in steady decline now. There are 200,000 bore wells sucking it up so fast that they say it's inevitable now it'll be gone. And here we're having another elections in the United States. Good heavens, watching that thing is stressful. But even the people who might be so-called on our side or closer to our worldview, nobody's talking about the elephant in the room, which is that there is a major crisis coming there. Let me tell you, I'm just finishing a new book called Boiling Point, Government Neglect, Corporate Abuse, and Canada's Water Crisis. And when I say Canada's water crisis, we have a water crisis. It's, people don't believe me because we have all grown up with this myth of abundance, but we are destroying, we are depleting, we are polluting, we are abusing our water as quickly as we possibly can. And the story of government neglect, not just the Harper government, and yes, let me say once again, the Harper government gutted every important water law that we have, and we absolutely have to demand of the new government that those be reinstated. But it wasn't just that government. It's been years and years of abuse, neglect, the federal government handing over to the provinces what should have been their responsibility, opening up through trade agreements like NAFTA and CETA with Europe and the Trans-Pacific Partnership coming up, the ability of corporations to tell us what to do with our water and how much. And I even quote in the book where legal scholars say that they think in the case of a treaty right and a NAFTA dispute that probably, or at least maybe, it would go to a NAFTA panel, but there's a very good chance that NAFTA would supersede treaty rights because an international treaty takes precedent over all domestic law. So would this treaty be more powerful than a treaty between the Canadian government and First Nations? A lot of legal scholars think so. These are very big, important things that we are doing that are placing our water at terrible risk. Meanwhile, we have no national drinking water standards. We have crisis on hundreds of First Nations on a regular basis across the country. We don't know where our groundwater is. We didn't have it mapped properly. We give it away. We basically let corporations do what they want with it. We grow food poorly, and so it. You know what happens because you're living right near Lake Winnipeg, one of the sickest lakes in the world. It was declared in 2013 to be the sickest lake in the world. We have to stop. We have to say this ends now. We have to have a new water ethic because we are responsible. We've heard this from everyone speaking here tonight. We are responsible. We are the stewards of this water. We are the stewards for our generation. It doesn't belong to these corporations. It doesn't belong to the pipeline companies. It doesn't belong to the energy companies. It doesn't belong to the politicians. It belongs to us. It belongs to the ecosystem. It belongs to other species. It belongs to the future. And we have no right to allow anyone to appropriate it for profit, and no right to allow anyone to... No right for any energy company to put in jeopardy the water sources of our communities. This is absolutely the most terrible thing we could do. Water is sacred. We have to establish and hear from our First Nations friends and leaders about how to reconnect, how to re-honor water, how to change that relationship. In our laws, water is property. It's a resource for us to use as we please. There's a famous quote from an advisor to Hooper in the 1930s when they were talking about putting in the major big dams, and he said, America will be great when she learns to conquer her water. So this notion of conquering water is very much a part of industrial urbanization in terms of our form of economic development, and frankly, we have exported it all over the world, and we have to stop. We have to protect watersheds, we have to restore watersheds, we have to do everything in our power to undo the harm we have done to water. And that means no expansion of the tar sands, no expansion of any of these pipelines, a change, a real commitment to alternative energy, a real commitment to a different way of trading across nations, a different way of growing our food. We have to say, if we don't do this now, we are not leaving a legacy of healthy water for our children, and they have every right to clean water. They have as much right to clean water and clean air as we do. So when they say to us, this is a great project, and Rick Mercer, you had it really wrong this time. When you say this is a great nation-building project like the railroad, which has lots of problems, by the way, it wasn't nation-building for those who died building it, but in any case, this notion that this is a great east-to-west project, this is a lie. This one spill, doesn't matter where it happens, one spill will divide us. One spill will be the place where people say, see, you made a decision that affected my water, that is killing the water. Look what's happened in Flint, Michigan. There are people whose children had drank water with lead in it. They'll never get it out of their systems. It's not something that's going to pass through. This isn't a one-off thing. This was a deliberate decision by wealthy people. Do you know that they knew that this water was poison, and they were warned, and they were drinking their own private water. They were not accessing this water even for bathing or using in their homes. I mean, this was a kind of an inside secret, because who cares about poor people? We have a situation in the world where this perfect storm of declining water sources, growing poverty, growing inequality, and rising water rates is meaning that in the so-called first world, we are also going to be faced with these issues. Detroit, they were at one point turning off the water to 3,000 families a week until some of us intervened. We got the UN to come and declare that they were actually violating the human rights of the people of Detroit. This is going to be a scenario more and more and more in our communities, until we stand up and say, you want to know what the great national goal is? Do you want to know what the great project for us that can bring us together? It's protection of water as a human right, as a public trust, as something that we have been given the honor, the privilege of being stewards for the next generation, and the next generation, and the next generation into seven generations. That's our job. And you cannot have that and Energy East. But we will make a choice.
About your drinking water coming out of tonight's event, tweet him.
Display your new window sign proudly. I think everybody here tonight had one of those, and there's an event coming up featuring Naomi Klein on April 8th, 7 p.m. We work with her fairly frequently. That's going to be a wonderful event. Clayton's going to be there. I encourage you to check that out. One of the other things that's on your chair is a membership form for the Council of Canadians. So we are a nonpartisan organization, not for profit. We're able to say and do what we do because we don't accept corporate funding, because we don't accept government funding, because we have over 100,000 supporters across the country and 60 volunteer chapters. If you're interested in supporting our organization, please take a look at that, take it home with you and fill it out, or give us a ring, ask us about what we do, or you can fill it out and drop it at the back. We're also going to, I'm going to ask the volunteers to circulate the donation buckets at this point. It's up to you, whatever you feel welcome to do, do or do not. But do know that the funds from the donation are going to be split between costs to cover this event, but costs to go towards another local organizing event on Energy East to support the local efforts here. So that's partially what you're going to be funding. And with that in mind, I thanked MJC, I thanked her co-sponsors. I want to make sure I thank the Winnipeg chapter, Mary, Brad, Doug, Penn, who wants to work. And what I want to do right now is open this up to Q&A. I know we're running a little late. We started a little late. We do have a microphone in the back there. I would encourage you to go to that microphone and line up if you have a question. I encourage you to keep it to actually frame it as a question as opposed to a statement, and to keep it to about 1 minute, and I'll take a couple of those questions, and then we'll go to our panelists. I won't let this go on beyond about 15 or 20 minutes. I apologize if you don't get your question asked, but the speakers will stay up here. I'll stay up here as long as we need to make sure that the questions are answered. Are there any questions tonight?
Hi, I just wanted to thank you for the work that you've done on the environment, and will there be a photo op at the end for Maude Barlow?
Thank you. Okay, well, we'll get to that. Please go ahead.
Can you explain in a little bit more detail what it means when Energy East is saying they're going to convert the pipelines?
Are there any other questions?
Quick question. Who owns the liability for this pipeline in the event of worst case scenario? Is it TransCanada Pipeline? Is it their subsidiary? Is it the government's? Thank you.
So yeah, these are great questions, so let's keep them going.
Does anybody at the front of the room know what the position of the NDP government of Manitoba is on the Energy East pipeline? They've been very quiet, and I'm a bit concerned about that.
This is for Maude, I suppose. Do you know if there's some sort of an official North American Intercontinental Watershed Alliance?
Bonjour, Danse. My name is Clayton Thomas Mueller, and I just want to say how moved I was by all the presentations. And my question is from my brother Daryl there. Can you say a little bit more about the best ways to support grassroots Indigenous organizing going on in Treaty 3? I know there's been powerful organizing work by a lot of the women in the territory. And can you talk any bit about this, if you know anything, about the status of the consultation agreement that Grand Council had signed with TransCanada, and where those community consultation processes are going, And is there any grassroots organizing going around those information sessions or whatever format that that process is taking? And are there ways we can support you know, that education process in a good way?
Great, that was a great list of questions. So I'm going to talk to one of them. You asked me to talk a little bit. Right. In terms of what they mean by converting the pipeline, I really hate to speak for TransCanada. It puts me in a difficult or challenging position. I would encourage you to take a look at their Energy East Pipeline website. They've got it all spelled out there. They held some open houses, but essentially, they're doing some like drilling down and doing some checks on the pipeline, but the pipeline itself remains the same. It stays the same. What they oftentimes talk about is sending pigs through. Pigs are ways to monitor it for corrosion from the inside, and industry will say one thing about the effectiveness of that, and then critics will say another. It gets quite technical, but essentially, like, let's not be under the guise that they're pulling up the pipeline and cleaning it out or changing it. That's not happening. It's the same pipeline. They're checking it for corrosion, and there's some other technical things that happen that you can read about on their website, so I hope that addresses your question with as much detail as I can provide, but do check out TransCanada's website. In terms of liability worst-case scenario, it's a good question, an important question. So one of the things the federal liberals are doing is looking at bringing something in that actually started, I believe, under conservatives, that would look at liability questions and who is liable. If you ask TransCanada, they'll say industry is liable. But if you look into the details, and to a degree, this new legislation that they're saying is going to pass the House of Commons will give $1 billion in liability that the industry is accountable for. But it gets tricky because it has to be proven that they're accountable for it, that it was actually caused by them. And going through the process of actually proving it's them versus the subcontractor who's doohickey, for lack of a proper word, was the source of the problem, right? It actually gets quite complicated, and we've seen that in pipeline spills. What we've also seen in a Kalamazoo spill, that it was well over $1 billion now. And with this particular pipeline, the spill could be even larger, so there's a question of will there actually be enough of the liability, and also would that put the financial capabilities of that particular corporation into question? I think that there's no hard and fast answer for that. I think they're all really important questions. Some of this will come out in the National Energy Board hearings that are going to happen, some of those sort of more technical details. But it's a really important question to keep asking. There's also a difference between TransCanada and Energy East Pipeline. So it looks like, or at least there's some concern that they're in separating Energy East Pipeline from TransCanada, that if Energy East Pipeline is held liable for it, what is their financial capability to cover the cost of a $1 billion spill versus TransCanada? You know, because that separation legally has happened. I don't have an answer for that. It's an ongoing question. It's important questions.
So part of, to go back to one of the last questions, part of the conversion includes building new pumping stations. Now, the NDP seems to want this pipeline to go through because the new pump stations would mean that Manitoba Hydro would get an extra 1,700 gigawatt hours of additional load by 2019 for upgrades to the pumping stations. That's big money for Manitoba Hydro. The NDP government doesn't seem to be interested at all in 1.5 or 2 degree climate change. The it also says, now I've got a copy of our latest report in my hand. It says that Manitoba Hydro has proposed a rate increase of 42% by 2024 to pay for the additional infrastructure needed to ensure the supply of surplus power for export sales and reliable power for the pump, for the pipeline pumping stations. They want to sell this at a reduced rate to TransCanada to feed these pumping stations. So the NDP government and Manitoba Hydro have a short-term business plan that rely on this pipeline going through. Now, I think it's important now during the time of the provincial election to hold each and every one of the candidates accountable for their stand, on climate change. It's the number one most important issue in the world and in politics right now. It can't be ignored. Any chance we get to draw a politician's attention to it, to ask them questions, to ask where they stand on climate change, on Energy East, we need to take that chance. We need to make it an issue that's a part of the elections right now. So every chance we get, we bring up climate change, we ask about Manitoba Hydro and the pump stations, and we say no to Energy East.
Okay, a very important question that came up by note.
And that is the argument that won't this replace transport by rail? And it's a really important question because the answer is, first of all, no, it won't. If they are successful, which they won't be, getting Energy East built, that will mean a huge increase, 40% increase in tar sands production, which means they'll be able to produce as much as the coal rail and the pipeline can carry. Also, it's very important to know that a lot of what the rail carries is not bitumen from the tar sands, but rather fracked oil. And it's a different thing. So stopping one doesn't mean that you're replacing it. Basically, we need to fight both. And as we move to a sustainable alternative, energy alternatives, we need to deal with both of these because fracking is just as big a problem. And believe me, we're very involved in the fracking issue in British Columbia and New Brunswick and everywhere else. On the question of, is there a North American Water Alliance, not per se in the sense that it's got a name, but we really work very closely with people in the United States and around the world. We call it Water Justice Movement, Global Water Justice Movement. Sometimes we call ourselves Water Warriors. And basically, I like to say to people that when you're fighting for a water system in your community, in your area, particular watershed, you are actually part of a global water justice movement. You may not sort of think about, you know, people doing the same thing in many other parts of the world, but the more we can protect the water, the more that we can tell each other about it, and we can make these links, the more we can actually become a force. And I just tell you, there are so many wonderful winning stories. One of them is that since the year 2000, 285 municipalities in 37 countries have re-municipalized their water after going private. So I mean, the whole notion that you can only go one way and you can't come back is not true. We can make sick water systems well again. We can stand up to these trade agreements. We can say no to the investor-state agreements or provisions of these agreements that give these corporations this power. We have to understand that we have more power collectively than these corporations do with our politicians. And so yes, there is great cooperation with groups like Food and Water Watch in the United States, but it really is a global movement. And when you stop Energy East Pipeline here, and when you clean up Lake Winnipeg, you will be a huge, huge part of that global movement. Thank you. We.
So I want to take this opportunity for thanking you all again for coming out tonight. I hope you feel like you've learned something tonight. I hope you feel inspired. I hope you take some of these actions, take a moment, sign that postcard, go back and talk to people, sign up your email, find out when the next NEJC or Council of Canadian Chapter meeting is, or Wilderness Committee, Memorial Action Centre. Plug in, get involved on this issue. Thank you so much to Chickadee and Daryl and Michael and Maude. And again, if you have any questions, if you'd like to take a picture, come on up here and we'll accommodate that. Thank you.